All right. All praise to the Most High, the creator of heaven and earth, the great spirit, Halito, grand rising, grand elevations to all the copper color aborigines out there. Going to get right into this video. I hope you guys enjoy it. Peace, love, and light. Let's go. All right, all praise to the Most High, the creator of heaven and earth, the great spirit, Halito, grand rising, grand elevations to all the copper color aborigines out there. We're going to get right into this video. Are the American Indians Hebrews? Are we Israelites? All right, this is always a debate. I truly believe we are God's chosen people. That's just my thought. You know, that's my thing. That's what I believe in. And I know a lot of other people may have another theory. But we're going to read some history today. We're going to get into some books. We're going to get into some history. We're going to watch a couple videos. And we're going to let the people decide. But I want to break this down. All right? Because this is very interesting. This is very interesting, to say the least. And we're going to break this down and let you guys see what's going on. And you be the judge. All right? Now, what you're looking at right now, you're looking at a stone they call the Back Creek Stone. All right? This is a rendition of the Ten Commandments in ancient Paleo Hebrew. All right? Now, this was found buried with an American Indian. Okay? An American Indian was buried with this stone. Okay? So, what would an American Indian be doing buried with a stone that has ancient Hebrew writing on it? That's the first question we got to ask ourselves. All right. So this book that we're reading right now, I have this book. I have the physical copy of it. I had it for about 10 years. It's called Feast and Wisdom of the Ancients by Time Life Books. It was published in 1990. All right. We're going to blow this up. Let's blow this up. It says the ancient Hebrews of Tennessee. All right. It says throughout the river valleys of the southeastern United States lie hundreds of man-made earthen mounds in which American Indians laid their dead to rest. But in one such mound, according to some researchers, there are non-Indian remains as well. The bones of Jewish refugees who may have fled the brutal Roman occupation of Palestine in the first century AD. Now, it says that there were non-Indian remains. What they're saying that when you read this book, the reason why they're saying non-Indian is because these people, the clothing they were buried with and the customs didn't resemble any Indians that they have seen. Okay, that's why they're saying non-Indians. This was a American Indian burial site. Okay, so to them, they like, we've never seen no American Indians like this before. Okay, so but just because you haven't seen it doesn't mean it is what you call it. They were all American Indians buried there. But it says the tomb first came to light in 1889 when a team from the Smithsonian Institution excavated three burial mounds along Back Creek in Loudoun County, Tennessee. In Loudoun County, Tennessee. It says nine skeletons were found in one mound, two of them set apart from the other seven. Beneath one of these two skeletons lay several unusual artifacts, among them a stone tablet bearing nine carved letters. And as you can see, the nine carved letters is here. All right, all ancient Hebrew. All right, now watch this. It says, the director of the mound excavation project, a man by the name of Cyrus Thomas, decided that the inscription contained letters of the Cherokee alphabet, which had been devised around 1820 by the Cherokee scholar Sequoia. So he just gave it a name. He didn't even know what it was. Cyrus Thomas, he, the dude who did the excavation, all right, he was the director of the excavation project. He just gave it what he wanted to give it, all right? He said, oh, that's Cherokee. He just dismissed it as Cherokee right off the bat. That's kind of crazy. You know what I'm saying? Watch this. It says the bones and the tablet were sent to the Smithsonian for later consideration. Thomas published his report in 1894, and there the matter seemed to rest. But in the 1950s, archaeologist Joseph Mahan happened upon a picture of the Back Creek tablet and reached a conclusion remarkably more exotic than Thomas's. It says Mahan knew the Cherokee alphabet, and as he wrote later, could see no relationship whatever between the symbols on the stone and those developed by Sequoia. So this dude said, look, I know the Cherokee alphabet well, and those letters that I see is not Cherokee. That's what he's telling them. He said, those letters is not Cherokee. All right. It says what Mahan did see upon turning the picture of the stone upside down was a striking similarity between several of the letters and ancient Canaanite writing. So he said he saw similarities between those letters on that stone and ancient Canaanite writing. Now, when it says Canaanite, it's referring to Israel. You have to know, if you know Bible, if you know scripture, you know that before the Israelites went into the land of Israel, it was called the land of Canaan. And then when the Israelites got into the land, it became the land of Israel. When the Israelites fled the land and was pushed out of the land, it became the land of Palestine. So wherever the Israelites are in the world, that is Israel. Because like I said, when the Israel, before they went into the land, it was called Canaan. When they got into the land, it was called Israel. When they left the land, it was called Palestine. So wherever the Israelites is, that's Israel. All right? It says, watch this. It says, no expert in Semitic languages, Mahan sent a photograph to Semitic language scholar Cyrus Gordon, who confirmed Mahan's observation. You see that? So they sent it to a Hebrew scholar, and he confirmed that the letters were indeed Hebrew. All right? It says, the characters, said Gordon, were from a Hebrew dialect dating to about the first century AD. They translated as a comet for the Jews. He speculated that one of the skeletons was that of a leader, the comet, memorialized by the tablet. Others who have compared the inscription with Cherokee, Paleo-Hebrew, and English characters take that position that, on the basis of their shapes, the carvings are as similar to English letters as to the Cherokee characters, but are even more like Hebrew, as Gordon said. You see that? Said it was more like Hebrew. It says, support for Gordon's assessment also comes from carbon-14 dating of wood fibers found with the skeletons. These tests reveal that the bodies were buried sometime in the first two centuries AD. To be sure, there are many reasons to question the scenario suggested by Gordon's translation of the inscription. For example, the other artifacts recovered at the Back Creek gravesite are clearly American Indian rather than Hebraic. And there is, of course, no hint in voluminous Hebrew lore of how any ancient Hebrews might have come to be among the Indians of Tennessee 1900 years ago. So just because there's no lore, that means you're trying to write it off as not being Hebrew? Like, the scholar already told you that it was Hebrew. And you got to understand, when these people who are doing these excavations and finding this information, they're not going to right off the back say, yes, this was Hebrew. These people don't know that already. They have to get scholars, and people have to come in, and they have to get archaeologists. They have to get language experts. All of these people have to come in and confirm this information, just like he did here with Mahan. He sent it to a Hebrew scholar, and he Cyrus Gordon, and Cyrus Gordon confirmed that it was in fact Hebrew. All right? And so we need to make sure we understand that. Okay, this is something you cannot write off. This is very interesting. Okay, and this book is called Feast and Wisdom of the Ancients by Time Life Books, published in 1990. I have a physical copy of the book. I've had it for about 10 years, so I already know what's there. I've read it many times. So, and this is just one of the most interesting things because, I mean, we got to take in consideration. You have to take in consideration. And I'll have to go over some more about this this Hebrew stuff. I have to go over some more about this so you guys, well, about this book, because there are some interesting other things in this book as well. All right?
Well, this here's my new drunk buster. This is my daughter, Catherine. Shalom aleikum, Jackson Two Bears.
Mr. Ballou, what's the use of saying shalom aleikum to me? I'm a full Sioux Indian. I'm not one of the chosen people.
All right, go ahead being stubborn if you want
it. Well, I ain't stubborn.
Oh, not much, you ain't. You know, according to an ex-congressman of these United States, I heard give a lecture at the Chautauqua this winter, Indians is the lost tribe of Israel, but he won't admit it.
Just ain't true.
He was an ex-congressman of these United States, I tell you.
Oh, Papa, maybe he was mistaken.
No, he was not. Jackson just got a mean, stubborn streak in him is all. I brought Mr. Bernstein, the telegraph operator, out here from town last month, and he stood right where you're standing now, and he talked Hebrew at Jackson for 10 minutes by my watch, and Jackson pretended he didn't understand a word. Now, I call that stubborn.
Well, I didn't understand a word.
You see what I mean? Now, you get that trunk down out of there. I'll get the satchel.
But let's get another book. This book is called... Lost Tribes and Promised Lands, The Origins of American Racism, all right? This book is done by Ronald Sanders. It was published in 1992. This is very interesting as well, but watch this. Let's go to page 77. Now, this is what I want you guys to pay attention to. Read this. Okay, watch this. We're going to read right here. It says, a striking element in Columbus's geographical religiosity is his intense and abiding interest in the fourth or second book of Esdras. Second Esdras, because the Bible today, the regular Bible that churches use, they have a Bible that has 66 books in it. But the original King James Version Bible had 80 books in it. And one of those books was the book of Esdras. You can even watch the movie 1492. When Christopher Columbus's buddy was asking him in the movie, he asked him, he said, why do you want to go take this trip over to America? And he said, the book of Esdras.
Why do you wish to sail west?
To open a new route to Asia. Asia is the richest kingdom, the land of spices and gold. At the moment, there are only two ways of reaching it. By sea, sailing around the African continent. The journey takes a year. Or by land. But the Turks have closed this route to all Christians. There is a third way. By sailing west across the ocean sea.
The distance is unknown. It's said to be infinite.
Superstition. I believe the Indies are no more than 750 leagues west of the Canary Islands.
How can you be so certain?
The calculations of Toscanelli, Marin de Tir, Esdras.
Esdras is a Jew.
So what's worse?
2 minutes. And already you're a dead man.
For telling the truth?
Yes. We are burning people for less.
So this is accurate in this book right here. These are primary sources. He said a striking element in Columbus's geographical religiosity, meaning he got this spiritual, you know what I'm saying, insight to take this trip. He said it is his intense and abiding interest in the fourth or second book of Esdras, because he was reading the book of Second Esdras and he knew people was on this side of the world. He knew people was in America. He was reading that book of Esdras, and that's how he knew. It says the two apocryphal books. Apocrypha means hidden books. All right. It says the two apocryphal books of Esdras purport to be additional writings by and about the Old Testament Ezra. So this is the same Ezra in the Old Testament. They just spelling his name Esdras. Okay. It says, but the second or fourth book is a piece of full-fledged Hellenistic apocalyptic writing that was often regarded with suspicion by the church. And when it says suspicion by the church, it's referring to the Roman Catholic Church. The reason why they regarded it with suspicion is because in that book, it talks about them being the devil and all that other stuff. And that's why they say it's with suspicion, because they know it's talking about them. All right. And it says, and just as often embraced by the heterodox, Augustine had been given guarded approval to Ezra's prophetic claims, and much was always to be made of this by the latter's defenders, including Columbus. In the marginal notes to Columbus's copy of De Aeli, it is a relatively lengthy discourse on 2 Ezra chapter 6, verse 42. All right? Now watch this. Let's go down and get some other pages. On page 92, watch what these people said. It says, we do not know much concerning Columbus's crew of about 90 men aboard the three ships, but at least one of them was an Israelite. You see that? One of them was an Israelite. Why did Columbus bring an Israelite with him? Because Columbus knew the people he was looking for was going to be speaking Hebrew. He knew that. Remember, he was reading the book of Ezra. So he automatically knew, okay, I need to bring somebody with me that speak Hebrew, because when I come across these people, they're going to be speaking the Hebrew language. He knew that. All right. It says, whose presence as such was not merely accidental. See, it says it wasn't an accident that he brought this Israelite. So he knew, I need to bring an Israelite with me. I need somebody who can speak Hebrew. It says, this was Luis de Torres, a convert of possibly only that year, who had once held a position with the governor of Mercia. He was said to have known Hebrew, Aramaic, that is the ancient language of the Israelites, Aramaic and Hebrew, it says, and some Arabic, and had been brought along by Columbus specifically as an interpreter. He brought this dude along as an interpreter to interpret for him. You understand this? All right, watch this. Okay, so now we're on page 364 of the same book. Watch this. Now this is talking about one of the guys, Francisco. Okay, he and Montezinos is explaining this story, how Francisco approached these American Indians. Watch this. He says, those Indians, he told himself, they are Hebrews. He said, these Indians is Hebrews, man. Because of their customs, the way they moved, the way they spoke, their customs. He said, man, these Indians is Hebrews, man. That's what he said. Now watch this. Let's go down to the bottom part and read this. It says, waving a banner high in the air, the Indian guide soon was greeted by a puff of smoke far beyond the other bank of the river in response to his signal. It says the two men waited. Eventually, a canoe appeared bearing three men and a woman, all of them Indians, to the place where Francisco and Montezinos were standing at the water's edge. The woman got off and spoke to Francisco in an Indian tongue that Montezinos could not understand. You see that? Now, Montezinos spoke an Indian language too. So when this woman was speaking, she was speaking in Hebrew. That's why he couldn't understand. It says, although he could perceive that he was being identified in the conversation, she then turned to her male companions to explain the situation. Upon hearing her words, they rose, went over to Montezinos, and to his utter astonishment, said, Shema Yisrael Adonai Elohanu, Adonai Ehad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. They had recited in Hebrew the fundamental credo of Judaism. So they spoke in Hebrew. It says, a brief conversation then ensued in their common ancestral tongue, according to Montezinos, whose fluency in it is almost as perplexing to the reader of his narrative as is that of his three mysterious new companions. They told him that they were themselves of the tribe of Reuben. So these American Indians told him they are from the Northern Kingdom, the tribe of Reuben. That is one of the Northern Kingdoms of Israel, one of the Northern Kingdoms that was referred to as Gentiles. When you read the book of Matthew chapter 4, okay, the Northern Kingdom was considered Gentiles. They were cut off in the book of Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 8. God said, the Northern Kingdom, you're no longer going to be my people no more. You're going to be Gentiles. Okay, and that was to the Northern Kingdom. So the tribe of Reuben, and it says, and that the tribe of Joseph lived on an island nearby. Tribe of Joseph is also a Northern Kingdom tribe. Okay, so they spoke in Hebrew. All right?
Shalom, YouTube. I felt compelled to make this video, for lack of a better term, and I'm going to entitle it, I'm Sick of White People. And yes, I'm white. And the reason I'm sick of white people is because no matter how much fact, no matter how much scripture you all are presented with regarding who the Hebrews in the Bible were and who they are in the earth today, which would be the so-called Negroes, Hispanics, the Native Americans, the Aborigines, no matter what you're presented with, you still want to dispute this and maintain your superior, pompous, arrogant attitudes. And it makes me sick. I come across these so-called biblically-based websites, and listed for the 12 tribes of Israel are all European countries. What is wrong with you people? You should be ashamed of yourselves. After everything these people have been through at the hand of the white man, slaughtered, ran off their land, sold into bondage, had their heritage stolen from them. Would it kill you? Would it kill you to acknowledge the fact that these could be God's chosen elect? Well, evidently so. And unfortunately, in the words of King Solomon, there's nothing new under the sun. As a matter of fact, I'd like to read what King David had to say regarding this. And this is from Psalm 83. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people, and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come, and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent. They have a confederate against thee, the tabernacles of Edom, that's you white people, Edom, and the Ishmaelites of Moab, the Hagarians, Gebal and Ammon, and Amalek, the Philistines, and with the inhabitants of Tyre. Ashur also is joined with them. They have holpen the children of Lot, Selah. So, you know, despite the fact that there's an African tribe with a piece of the Ark of the Covenant, and despite the fact that it's been proven that Native American tribes wrote in ancient Hebrew, a very, very ancient form of Hebrew, You still want to think that you're Israelites. And I hate to break it to you white people, but you are not. You are Edom. You are Edomites, the descendants of Esau, Jacob's brother.
Now, I want to go get the book of Esdras to show you guys why Columbus believed to come on this side of the world. This is the book of Esdras. Okay, this is the book that was taken out of the King James Version Bible. Because when the King James Version Bible was first translated, it was translated in 1611. Okay, 47 of the best Hebrew and Greek scholars of the day got together and took the Bishop's Bible and translated and created this King James Version, because many people think that King James wrote the Bible. King James never wrote the Bible. He just authorized a new translation. He never wrote the Bible. King James authorized the translation of a new version called the King James that came from the Bishop's Bible. Okay, and they took that and translated it into the King James. And when they first translated it, it had Second Esdras in it. But if you go by a regular King James Bible today, you would just have 66 books and it won't have the book of Esdras in it. That's why you have to make sure if you're gonna get a Bible, get the King James Version with the Apocrypha. Make sure the Apocrypha is in it, and that way you will be able to have what we're about to read here, all right? So it says, so right here, what's going on is Esdras is having a dream, all right? The prophet Esdras is having a dream, and he is seeing a bunch of people in this dream. So he asked the Most High in the previous verses before verse 40, okay? We in 2 Esdras chapter 13, verse 40. In the previous verses before that, he asked the Most High, he said, who is these people that I'm seeing in this dream? Who are these people? So Esdras says, so the Most High told him, the Most High told Esdras, those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoner out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king, whom Salmanassar, the king of Assyria, led away captive. And he carried them over the waters, and so they came into another land. But they took this counsel among themselves, that they would leave the multitude of the heathen and go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt. Because during this time, the northern kingdom was taken into captivity. They got taken into the Assyrian captivity per 2 Kings chapter 17 and verse 6. So during this time, they were taken to different lands and they took on the customs of the people of the lands where they were taken to. So it says they took the counsel among themselves that they would leave these other nations, the heathen. You know, the heathen are always called other, any other nation that's not a God's chosen people, they would call them a heathen. So it says these people left the heathen and they would go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt. Now, when you look at history and you look at this time, this is around 760 BC, all right? So when you look at this time period, or around 733, somewhere up in there, between 733 and 760 BC. Now, when you look at this time period, okay, because it says where never mankind dwelt. If you look at this time period, Europe was occupied at this time, Africa was occupied at this time, and Asia was occupied at this time. The only place that was not occupied at that time was America, okay? This is the teaching that's always going forth. So that's why it says where never mankind dwelt, okay? That they might keep their statutes, which they never kept in their own land. And they entered into Euphrates by the narrow places of the river. For the Most High then showed signs for them and held still the flood till they were passed over. So this is referring to the Bering Straits. All right, that's what it's referring to, because when the Bering Straits is not dry and water is there, the waters are very violent. So it says the Most High showed signs for them and held still the flood, meaning he held still the flood till they were passed over, meaning he dried up the land so they could cross over. That's why it says held still the flood till they were passed over, meaning he dried up the land and allowed them to go over to the other side of the world. And when the Bering Straits dries up, a land appears called Beringia, okay? A land appears called Beringia, okay? And that's what it's talking about, all right? But watch this. It says, for through that country there was a great way to go, namely a year and a half. And that same region is called Arsareth. You see that? Arsareth. So when you look at the word Arsareth, okay? Many people do not know that one of the names, because America had a few different names, All right. And many people don't know that one of the names for America was Arsareth. That was one of the names for America. Okay. Now, from there, we're going to go to the Jewish encyclopedia so we can get some information about this word Arsareth. We want to see what is Arsareth and where does it come from? Because this word is in the Jewish encyclopedia, which is going to back up what we just read out the Bible. All right? Now watch this. The Jewish encyclopedia, okay? Hold on, let me go over here. Let me blow it up for you guys. Okay, this is from the JewishEncyclopedia.com. All right, Arsareth. It's same Arsareth, it's just spelt a little different. It's spelt with a Z instead of a S, but it's the same Arsareth. It says, the name of the land beyond the great river, far away from the habitation of man, in which the 10 tribes of Israel will dwell, observing the laws of Moses until the time of the restoration. According to 2 Ezra 13 and 45. You see this? This is the same thing we just read right here. 2 Ezra 13 and 45. It's in the Jewish Encyclopedia. 2 Ezra 13 and 45. It says Columbus identified America with this land. So Columbus identified Arsareth as America. This is in the Jewish Encyclopedia. This is in the 1906 Jewish Encyclopedia. It says Columbus identified America as Arsareth. All right? So that's how Columbus knew to come over here. But let's get some more history. All right? This book is called Mystery of the Mexican Pyramids by Peter Tompkins. Mysteries of the Mexican Pyramids by Peter Tompkins. This was published in 1987. All right. Let's read what it says. It says right here. It says, in a manuscript written in Quiche in 1554 by several Maya Indians, its Spanish translator, Pedro Denisio Jose Chone, had this to say. It is supposed in the manuscript that the three great Quiche nations mentioned in particular are descendants of the 10 tribes of the Kingdom of Israel, whom Shalmaneser reduced to perpetual captivity, and who, finding themselves in the confines of Assyria, decided to emigrate. The actual text ran, these then were the three nations of Quiches, and they came from where the sun rises, descendants of Israel, of the same language, meaning they spoke Hebrew, and the same customs, meaning they were keeping the laws of Moses. You see this? So this is another one of the books. I have this book too. I have the physical copy of T. A lot of these books I've already had for a long time, so I already knew, you know what I'm saying, exactly what books to go to, because I've had them for a while and I've read all of them. So I know exactly where to find these passages and all of that, because like I said, people, you got to understand, especially back in the 1800s, a lot of people thought that our ancestors were Israelites, Jews. They thought that because the customs that they had, the ceremonies, the way they spoke, the language they spoke, the way they moved, they said these people move like the Israelites. They move like Jews. They move like God's chosen people. And I don't see nothing wrong with being God's chosen people. I don't see not one thing wrong with that. All right? But let's get on. Let's get to a... let's get to another book, all right? This book is called, again, this book is called Mysteries of the Mexican Pyramids by Peter Tompkins, in case you guys want to get that book. And like I said, a lot of our people A lot of people back in the day, they had missionaries. Listen, they had people that would talk about this back then. They had pastors, scholars, historians. These people were talking about this back then. Back in the 1800s, this was big. This was big, a big thing. This was very big, especially when you had books like Views of the Hebrews by Ethan Smith, A Star in the West. All of these books like that, missionaries and pastors who talked about this stuff and said, yes, the American Indians are Hebrews. These people were 100% sure that the American Indians were Hebrews, all right?
This is the Decalogue stone with the Ten Commandments written on it, on all sides of it. And this is a stone box that the Decalogue was found in.
Okay.
So when it was found, it was enclosed in this box and you couldn't even see the stone inside. The box is carved out inside exactly to fit the Decalogue stone.
Well, who's that guy?
Well, this figure here on the front that's wearing a robe and a turban and holding either tablets or a breastplate. And over his head, in these Hebrew letters, it says Moshe or Moses.
Oh.
So that's must be Moses.
Okay, that's Moses, all right.
Who delivered the Ten Commandments.
Ten Commandments, okay, well. It seems to pass the scrutiny of the skeptics as far as the Hebrew text in the language. So now I'd like to try to add some evidence to this whole discussion. Polished after it was carved. It scratched like I would expect. Well, it fits snug.
So the box in itself took an awful lot of work. I mean, if it was really a forgery, you wouldn't go to all that much trouble to make a box for it. So I think that speaks to its authenticity, that someone really was, this was very important to someone.
This is a lot of work, and it's polished. It's got the detailing of the grooves. It wasn't made, as far as I can tell, from modern machinery. Geologically, I don't see any problems here that would make these things obvious hoaxes. So the skeptics have rejected this.
Well, that's been a factor, but Hebrew's an odd thing to find here.
The fact that it's odd doesn't mean that it's not genuine. What it boils down to is really the problem with these artifacts is that the academics don't like them because they don't fit the paradigm. And unfortunately for them, you can't dismiss things simply because you don't like them.
Right.
And so the evidence to me seems clear. There's no reason not to accept these as genuine, legitimate artifacts.
Watch this though. Let's get another book. This book is called Origins of the American Indians, European Concepts, 1492 to 1729 by Lee Eldridge Huddleston. All right. Watch this. It says, despite the Jewish descent of the Indians, their remoteness from the old world freed them from any guilt in the death of Christ, and their ready acceptance of Christianity from the Spaniards argued well for them. You see, it says their ready acceptance of Christianity. See, when the Europeans and them Europeans and them Spanish start coming over here, they brought religion with them. And they started, and any of our people that did not accept Christianity, they put them to death. All right? They put them to death. That's exactly what was happening back then. And it says, although they were once idolaters, argued, we must judge them as one of the noblest people on earth. This conclusion seems inconsistent with an adherence to the Issachar variant of the Lost Tribes theory, but Vasquez gave no evidence concern over a possible inconsistency. You see that? Watch this. It says, watch this. It says, the only other writer this author found who accepted the Issachar variation of the 10 Lost Tribes theory was Balthasar de Medina in Cronica de la Santa Provincia de San Diego de Mexico of 1682. Although Medina thought the South Americans and Yucatans were descendants of the Gentile Icatan, father of Ofer, the Mexicans are originally of the 10 tribes captured by Salmanazar of the family of Issachar, whom the Indians recognize as their special ancestors. So when you go get a book, okay, when you go get in the book of Genesis, there's a scripture in the book of Genesis where it talks about, because when you go to Mexico, okay, in Mexico, there's a city called Tula in Mexico, T-U-L-A, Tula. In the Bible, in Genesis chapter 46 and 13, I should go to it. Let me see. I think I can find it. Let me go up here. Genesis 46 and 13. There is a son of Issachar, and his name is, what a coincidence, Tula. You see that right there? It says, and the sons of Issachar, Tula. There is a Tula, Mexico. You can just Google that. Type in Tula, Mexico. T-U-L-A. It's spelled a little different, but it's the same Tula. And it is not a coincidence that the son of Issachar's name is Tula, and there is a Tula, Mexico. Tula is a Hebrew word. That's not a coincidence. So there could be a correlation here. There could be a real correlation here. Okay? You got to put this stuff in mind. You got to keep this stuff in mind, because I know a lot of y'all don't want to hear nothing about the Bible. Y'all despise the scriptures and all. I hear that. I get it. I understand it. But at the end of the day, you have to use information to connect the dots. I'm not saying let's just take the Bible at 100% fact and blah, 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 blah. I'm not telling you what to do. If you don't believe the Bible, that's your problem. I have no problem with that. But what I'm saying is we have to correlate information. And you can't. That's why I read from the Bible dictionary in my last presentation. We have to correlate information. You can't shun stuff to the side, because you never know what information is, certain pieces to the puzzle that you're forgetting to read because you won't pick up the book. Don't look at it as a book of religion. Just look at it as information and get the information if you don't believe in God. I believe in the Most High. And I believe we God's chosen people. So I don't know about what you believe. That's up to you. And I'm not trying to force you to believe anything. I'm just trying to connect the dots for you. All right? So it says that the Mexicans are originally of the 10 tribes captured by Salmanazar of the family of Issachar. And it is not a coincidence that Issachar has a son named Tula, and that there is a Tula, Mexico. That is not a coincidence at all. All right? So let's move on to another book. This book is called Mysteries of the Past by Lionel Casson. This was published in 1977. All right? Let's read what it says. Right here, let's go here. I'm gonna blow it up for you. We're gonna start up here where it says 1641. It says, in 1641, Antonio de Montezinos, a Portuguese Jew, made a voyage to South America and reported that while journeying near Quito in Ecuador, he met up with a native who, to his astonishment, was Jewish. Was Jewish. You see this? It says, what is more, the man took him on a arduous week-long trip through the hinterland to a remote spot where an entire community of Jews was living. You see that? He took him there. He said it was all Indians there that was Jews. Watch this. It says, Antonio actually heard them recite in Hebrew the traditional prayer, "Hear, O Israel," returning to Europe. He reported his find to Manasseh ben Israel, the most eminent Jewish scholar of the day and an author who had wide readership among non-Jews. So this dude, everybody knew this dude for his scholarly work in Hebrew and Jewish studies. It says, no less an artist than Rembrandt was illustrator for one of his books. It says Manasseh published the spectacular news in a slim volume called The Hope of Israel, which, written originally in Spanish, was swiftly translated into Latin, Hebrew, and English. The English version went into three editions within 2 years. The notion that the lost tribes of Israel had crossed the ocean to America had struck others as much as a century earlier, but Manasseh was the one who brought it to public attention, who launched it on its extended career. It says, before long, Antonio's tale of Israelites who had wandered to America was escalated into a theory which put them among the founders of the New World civilization, a theory that reached its heyday in the 19th century. Britain's Lords Kingsborough, for example, went through the family fortune and landed in Debtor's Prison no less than 3 times. He died there the last time in order to publish deluxe, superbly illustrated volumes proving that the Mexican Indians were descendants of the lost tribes. You see that? He said he went through the family fortune and published a superb volume proving that the Mexicans were descendants of the lost tribes. Do y'all see that? This is what it's all about, piecing the information together. All right? So you got to remember, like I said, a lot, there were missionaries. There were people who spoke about this stuff and wrote about this stuff. Y'all saw the video I posted. You see the movie I posted, Cat Balu. You see the dude said, Injun here is the lost tribe of Israel, but he won't admit it. You see, he said that in the video. So a lot of people thought, and I know people going to say, well, that was a Mongoloid, blah, blah, blah. I get it. I only posted the video to show you the correlation. All right. That's all I was posting it for. Because y'all, I know y'all be, I get it. I understand. You know, I understand a lot has been taken from us. So a lot of y'all is sensitive and y'all want to fight everybody. I get it. I understand it. All right. I'm with you. But just understand, I played the video just to show the correlation. All right. Now watch this. Let's get the this book. This book is called The History of the American Indians by James Adair. All right. And after this, I'm going to play a video of a pastor. He's going to be talking about the same thing. But this book is called The History of the American Indians by James Adair. All right. This was published around 1775. James Adair actually lived with our ancestors. Okay. So he was there with them. He saw everything. All right. And that's why I like this book. So this book is called The History of the American Indians by James Adair. And James Adair actually lived with our ancestors. So he saw the customs. He saw everything about these people. So he is the best one to speak on where these people are from because he actually lived with them. All right. Now watch this. Let's read what he said. It says, some have supposed the Americans to be descendant from the Chinese, but neither their religion, laws, customs, and agree in the least with those of the Chinese, which sufficiently proves they are not of that line. He said people thought these American Indians were of the Chinese because they were calling them dark Asiatics in this book. All right. Because of the slanted eyes. But some of them had woolly hair. Some of them had wavier hair. Some of them had straightened hair. He explains everything in this book. And this book, almost half of this book talks about the American Indians being Jews, being Israelites. All right. Watch this now. Let's go down to the next page. Watch what he says here. He says, from the most exact observations I could make in a long time, I traded among the Indian Americans, I was forced to believe them lineal descendant from the Israelites. He said, from the long time that I've been around these people, okay? And I traded amongst these American Indians. I was forced to believe them lineal descendant of the Israelites. Why is he saying that? Because of the customs, the clothing that they wore. They had the fringes with the border of blue. The ceremonies, all of that. This is one of the laws in the Bible, all right? Numbers chapter 15, verse 38, all right? It says, speak unto the children of Israel and bid them that they make them fringes in the border of their garments throughout their generations, and that they put upon the fringe of the borders a ribbon of blue. All right? And when you see a lot of American Indians, they have that fringe and that border of blue. They have that custom. And that's one of the reasons people thought that they were the Israelites. All right? But watch this. Let's go to page 19 now. Okay, watch this. It says, the ceremonies of the Indians and their religious worship are more after the Mosaic institution than of pagan imitation. He said, the Indians, their ceremonial worship is more after the Mosaic institution, meaning the law of Moses. All right? He said, their ceremonies is after the law of Moses than of pagan imitation. He said, which could not be if the majority of the old natives were of heathenish descent. For all bigots and enthusiasts will fight to death for the very shadow of the superstitious worship when they have even lost all the substance. There yet remain so many marks as to enable us to trace the Hebrew extractions and rites through all the various nations of Indians. They say they can trace the Hebrew extractions and rites through all the various nations of Indians. And we may, with a great deal of probability, conclude that if any heathens accompanied them to the American world or were settled in it before them, they became proselytes of justice. A proselyte is a convert. And it says, and their pagan rites and customs were swallowed up in the Jewish. It says, if any people that were not Jews, that were not Israelites, came amongst these American Indians, they would have been converts. He said the American Indians would have converted these people over. That's how strong their Jewish customs were. That's how great of an influence they had with the Jewish customs. All right? That's what he's saying. All right? Now, watch this. From there, let's go to page 214. We're going to go to page 214. All right, we're on page 214 now. It says, Acosta writes that the clothes of the South American Indians are shaped like those of the ancient Jews, being a square little cloak and a little coat. And the Reverend Mr. Thorogood, Anno 1650, observes that this is a proof of some weight in showing their original descent, especially to such who pay a deference to Seneca's parallel arguments of the Spaniards having settled Italy. For the old mode of the dress is universally alike among the Indian Americans. Do you see this? So all of these people that were going through and that were calling the American Indians Hebrews, they were doing so based on their customs. They didn't want to call them Hebrews just because. It was all based on their customs, the way they spoke, the language, the clothing that they wear, their ceremony and religious worship, all of that. All right? That's why they were calling them Israelites. That's why they were saying they were Hebrews. And we're going to come back to this, and we're going to do a part two to this video, all right?
What you need to understand was that when Columbus asked for permission to come to the Americas, the first word he called this place was Arseret. when he was asking for permission. You don't even have to go read a book. Go watch the movie 1492. It's in the movie. He said, I want to go to Arsareth. And they asked him, they say, oh, how did you find out about Arsareth? He said, it's in the book of 2 Esdras. And what you don't know is that out of all the people Columbus put on his boat to bring with him on the Santa Nina, well, what is it, the Pinta? Pinta Santa Maria? The Nina Pinta Santa Maria. It came back. Thank you, Lord. Out of all the people that he brought with him, he brought an interpreter. And guess what language he made sure that his interpreter spoke? Hebrew. Woo! You better go dig. You better go. How you knew when you got here you was going to need to communicate with Hebrews? How you knew that? Nazareth. You see? Nazareth. You see? Yeah. Pastor, what you're saying? You see, these fellas who wrote in the 1800s, A View to Hebrews, Pastor Ethan Smith, James Adair, Elias Boudinot, 1816, Congressman Boudinot, and people like William Penn, who founded the city of Philadelphia and Pennsylvania, rather, is named after him. They had a theory back then. The theory was that the people we call the Indians, who when they got to America, they say, you know, not Columbus knew, but everybody else is like, what are all these people doing here? See, back in those days, the 1800s, most people knew of the theory that the Native Americans were the 10 tribes. Most people knew that. Most people knew that. It was preached in church. That's why, listen, I got pastors, man. The testimonies, they pastors, missionaries, man. Missionaries. And I'm talking about not just pastors, no, but pastors that we learn about in English, sinners of the hands of an angry God. Jonathan Edwards, his son was a missionary amongst the Indians, and his son knew that they were the people. His son knew. They knew it. They always knew it. They knew it when Columbus stepped foot on the land. They knew it. And I'm going to show you the next few weeks and months, I'm going to show you. I'm going to give you so much evidence, it's going to blow your mind. It's going to blow your mind. Because when I talk about the people of God, you will see them and know them by the curse, by the judgment. Let me tell you another group of people who done had it rough, who done experienced a lot of depression and all manner of wickedness done to them. Not only the Hebrews, hallelujah, not only African Americans, amen, but the Native Americans. Reading their history make you want to weep. Make you want to weep. But we had good white men, good Caucasian Europeans stand up and write books about it. And say, oh, no. Y'all ain't going to just let this slide and hide this under the rug. No. We're going to let y'all know. We'll let y'all know in 2018, huh? Keep the record that we always thought they was the people. And we're going to give you the evidence of it. Listen to me good. All right? Listen to me good. When we come next time, look, we're going to study all manner of kind of things. And I got stuff bubbling up in me that I want to tell you right now. I don't want to hold it. Let me tell you one. Did you know when they first came, not Columbus, but the settlers, pilgrims? Brother Abby, you know who they brought with them to communicate with these Indians? They bought them slaves from West Africa. Now, how Tyrone gonna communicate with Geronimo? What Tyrone and Geronimo know? That's what Tyrone come up in there. And that Indian come up in there, and them all looking at each other, checking each other. He big like me. And they would communicate. Check out the explorers Lewis and Clark. Find out who the guide of Lewis and Clark was. black man by the name of York, a slave. One of the greatest assets to the expedition. Without York, Lewis and Clark could tell you, the expedition of finding out the West would have never happened. Because York was their liaison to negotiate with the Indians and talk with them. They could understand each other.
Woo! So I hope you guys enjoyed this. I hope you guys been edified. Peace, love, and light.